So, Nvidia has already announced their new graphics card, the 30 series RTX, which promises a lot of performance, a lot of boost in performance, especially compared to the last generation, for a fairly reasonable price. And some of you might be considering upgrading their PCs to match that newly found power to play in 4K or 2K at high, very high FPS. And while it might be wise to wait for AMD to make their move, especially that we already know when the conferences will happen. So the CPU conference will happen on 8th of October and the graphics card conference, where we'll hear more about RDNA 2 graphics card, will happen on 28th of October. If you can't wait that long and want to build your PC right now, which can also be a valid point, and while why it might be a valid point, I'll answer at the end of the video. So if you want to hear that, just skip till the end. You can still make a pretty good gaming PC and make yourself future-proof for the upcoming next generation. And this video is about choosing the right CPU for your budget, mid-range and high-end build. Hi, I'm Laser. Welcome to my channel where we talk about gaming and hardware. And like I said in this video, we'll talk about which CPU best fits your budget and your needs. So for anyone looking for a cheap gaming CPU that will still allow you to play the latest games in a very high resolution, very high frame rate, the best choice is the Ryzen 3300X. Why? Well, first of all, it can match and sometimes overtake the much more expensive 3600 in terms of gaming performance. The reason behind it is the architecture that the Ryzen CPUs are built on, but we'll not get into much detail on that because it'll take another probably 20 minutes to explain the reason behind it. So let's just leave it for another time, for another video. The 3300X offers 4 cores and 8 threads, so it's still pretty capable of playing the newest titles. It has 3.8 GHz base clock speed and 4.3 GHz turbo clock speed. It also has 18 MB of cache. But let's put the specs aside and have a look at something that's more important. So real life performance in games and how the 3300X looks beside the competitors, so the 3600X and Intel's counterparts. In Shadow of the Tomb Raider on Ultra settings, we can see that the 3300X performs 15% slower than the 3600X and 20% slower than the i5-10600K, while costing almost half the money than the Intel CPU. In Tom Clancy's Rainbow Six Siege, the 3300X performs almost at the same level as the 3600 and only 6% slower than the i5 from Intel. In Far Cry 5, we see similar performance differences between 3300X and 3600. The difference is just 5 FPS, which you will probably never notice anyway. The difference in performance between 3300X and i5 is around 13%, so also very marginal, especially when we take into consideration the price. This just shows that the 3300X for most users will be more than enough to play the modern games and on pretty high settings as well. What's also surprising is that we can see no real bottleneck on the performance level when paired with a strong GPU. So anyone worried that matching 3300X with an RTX 2070 or 2080 will be a problem, and relax. So I think it's pretty safe to assume that even though it's a budget gaming CPU, it still offers pretty strong performance. It might not be as future proof as the 3600 or i5 or even the Ryzen 7 series, but for now it's more than enough to play all your favorite games. Mid-range builds is where it gets really interesting, because we have two scenarios really. The first one is a pure gaming PC where you just care about the gaming performance and nothing else matters, and the other scenarios where you want to also include some performance and productivity applications in video editing, for example. So let's start with the gaming performance, and here we have our clear winner, which is the Core i5-10600K from Intel. The Core i5-10600K offers very good performance, especially when overclocked, then it shows its true power. When overclocked, it can match the Core i7-10700K and Core i9-10900K before overclocking, of course. It's also cheaper than the Ryzen 7 3700X and offers better performance in games. It has 4.1 GHz base clock speed with 4.8 boost speed. It has 6 cores and 12 threads, so that's enough for a couple of years when it comes to gaming. Especially that games really don't use much more than those 6 cores and 12 threads. So let's have a look at the benchmarks now. In Battlefield 5, Core i5 gives us 11 more frames than the 3700X, which we will compare it to, which is roughly 7% more, and still remember, it's cheaper than the 3700X. In Metro Exodus, the difference is slightly higher at 13%, which means it can display 13 frames more. In Shadow of the Tomb Raider, both CPUs offer very similar performance, with only 2 FPS difference, which means that there is a GPU bottleneck and the game really relies heavily on the GPU performance. We can clearly see from the benchmarks that Intel is the clear winner here. When you're interested only about the gaming performance, you should definitely go with Intel because first of all, the performance is important, second of all, it's cheaper than the Ryzen 3700X. Now what about the mixed scenario where apart from gaming you also want to do some productive work like video editing, compiling your code or doing something different? Then the situation changes dramatically because the Ryzen 7 3700X offers fantastic multitasking performance and is much better choice than the Core i5 from Intel. Ryzen 7 3700X outmatches the Core i5 when it comes to productivity and by a quite margin, matching Core i7 10th gen while costing quite a bit less. If you're more on the budget side, a good consideration might also be the Ryzen 5 3600, which although offers slightly worse performance in games than the Core i5, it can beat it in performance when it comes to applications. Now let's have a look at the high-end tier where money is of little importance and you want to really squeeze out the last number of FPS from your games. Just bear in mind that you're entering the area of diminishing returns, so the more you spend on your CPU, the less impact and performance difference you will notice in your games. But if you're all about that competitive edge, the additional 5 frames per second are very important for you, this is where you should be looking at. And we already saw some charts from benchmarks, so you probably know what the outcome of this part is. Core i9 and Core i7 are leading the charts. It's worth noting that the Core i9 in Shadow of the Tomb Raider offers much better low FPS performance, which means that the difference between average FPS and minimum FPS would be much lower, which means it's less stuttery and no sudden performance drops. In Rainbow Six Siege, the Core i7 and Core i9 almost tie, which brings up the question whether Core i9 is really worth the additional money you have to pay for it. In my opinion, it's not worth it. Well, what about Ryzen? Well, the Ryzen 3900X is still a very good choice, especially for people who consider the amount of money you have to pay for the CPUs. It's only 7% slower than the Intel Core i9 10th gen, and it can match it and sometimes even beat it in the productivity performance charts. So like in the previous segment, if you want to build a gaming PC that will also help you do your work, edit your videos, compile your code, then the Ryzen CPU will be a much better choice for a much more affordable price. It costs around 20% less than the Core i9. So let's sum up quickly. When it comes to gaming, Intel still holds the crown as the best gaming CPU you can get, especially for mid-tier and high-end tier. And the answer for that is simple, it just has higher clock speeds, much higher clock speeds than the Ryzen CPUs, which still matters in most of the games. Now, if you want to go for a more budget build, the 3300X has no competition whatsoever, especially that the Core i3, which stands at a similar price point, has no hyper-threading, so you only get 4 cores and 4 threads, while Ryzen 3300 offers 4 cores and 8. And now time for the bonus part, which I promised you at the beginning of the video, and my reasons why you shouldn't really opt for the newest and latest from Intel or AMD or Nvidia. And the reason for that is simple, stability. New technology, when it comes out, it needs some time to really mature, to really get tested in a lot of configuration, different configurations with different CPUs matched with different GPUs. And the process is quite painful, especially for the early adopters who decide to go for the latest and newest, because they face blue screens, they face stability issues, they face sometimes performance drops, which is a normal life cycle of every product. Whenever something new is released, it has to be tested by us, by the users, unfortunately. But in the end, everything turns out fine because every manufacturer cares about their product lifecycle, cares about the experience the user has, and sooner or later they release bug fixes, patches that address all those issues. But if you're the kind of person who really cares about the stability of your system and you just want to buy a CPU, buy a graphics card and just play and not worry about any performance issues or stability issues, then I strongly recommend going with the current generation, at least for the CPU part. You're much safer when you go with Ryzen 3000 series or Intel 10th generation. You'll face much fewer technical issues, and just because the products are on the market for much longer time. I still think that even if you're considering buying a new gaming CPU, the additional 1 month of wait before Ryzen releases the new CPUs is worth the wait for two reasons. First of all, you will have a much clearer picture of what's in stock for the future. Second of all, the prices of Ryzen 3000 series are bound to drop, so you'll probably pay much less for your gaming CPU than you would pay now. The best thing you can do to kind of future-proof yourself and allow yourself to buy a new CPU when the Ryzen 4000 series are out and they already, you know, they have been tested and patched and everything is working fine, is just getting a right motherboard. You can buy a motherboard which will run your Ryzen 3000 series CPU and supports a Ryzen 4000 series CPU. There is a list from AMD of the supported motherboards with the list of chipsets that will work with the Ryzen Zen 3 architecture CPUs. I'll link them in the description of the video so you can check out for yourself. So with that in mind, I hope you enjoyed the video. If you have any comments, suggestions or questions, just ask them in the comments. I'll try to answer all of them. Thank you for listening, thank you for watching, and I'll talk to you soon.